All right, I'm just gonna go ahead and start then. My name is Leanna Pancoast. I have made these beautiful wedding invitations that are getting passed around right now. And I'm here to talk about the art and the programs that I used to make that and kind of the electronics that went into it. And there's a little goof that happened that just I was able to just keep going along with while I mailed them out. So before any wedding starts, there's a proposal, probably. And my fiance was able to propose with a box with a light that turned on because he knew that I liked LEDs, and that happened at around the same time I kind of got laid off, so I was able to really explore my love for LEDs again. So I got into making these light boxes. I wanted to make one for my newly born nephew, and I was able to learn some electronics, where, if this is the right video, I used a capacitive sensor using some things off of Amazon and an LED driver in order to get this to light up and be a really nice night light. While my fiance was watching me do that, and we got to the topic of the wedding invitations, he's like, hey, let's make a PCB wedding invitation. So he saw these PCBs here, the stereotypical very green, white silk screen with metal stuff going on, and this is probably what he was thinking about when he said, let's make a PCB invitation of just have this green, white, and yellow theme and just get it printed at a normal print shop of just a standard paper invitation. But I had seen these these cats on Osh Park, on Hackaday, where someone was talking about how they were taking advantage of Osh Park's newly released After Dark service. And I really liked the look of the gold against the black and thought we could do something for our wedding invitation. If we're gonna go make a PCB one, let's just make it an actual PCB. So I started explaining to him what goes into a printed circuit board. So I'm gonna look at the top here. Can you see my mouse? Yes, okay. This FR4 here is the substrate where a lot of PCBs are made. This can be replaced with other things, but in a standard hard printed circuit board, you'll get FR4, which is a type of fiberglass. And it has this yellow, light yellow color. The other process in the printed circuit board making process is depositing this copper, this metal layer that will make up all the traces and all the wires connecting all of your components together. And on top of that, they put on some sort of non-reactive coating. The two most common ones are going to be HASL, which is hot air solder leveling, which is going to be a really thin layer of solder against all of the metal on the boards. And the other common coating is enig, or electroless nickel gold, where on top of the copper they put a very thin layer of nickel to act as a bonding part, and then they put gold on top of that, and that's where the yellow color comes from, the golden color, that is actual gold on top, because gold is a very non-reactive metal. To prevent shorts, when you actually put the components onto the printed circuit board, there's this material called solder mask, which really, really rejects the materials that are in solder in order to prevent shorts. And then on top of that is typically a silk screen, which traditionally is white. The After Dark service and the cats down here show a few different colors where they swapped out the solder mask color from green to black. And then they exposed holes in the solder mask to be able to see the color of the FR4 as well. And then you can also drill right through the printed circuit board, all of the layers, to reveal holes there. So now that I've explained to my fiance of how a PCB is made and to get the understanding that there's only certain colors we can work with, about three or four, depending on what you're working on, we can get to designing. So in order to get your own art, there's a few different ways. If you would like someone else to make it, then there's a bunch of marketplaces online where you can just scroll through designs that other artists have made. I put Silhouette Design Store up here. Silhouette makes vinyl cutters, typically for consumer use, where people can make stickers and just t-shirts and paper craft. The other popular one is Cricut. Adobe Stock is just a list of like images of stock images. There are also like Getty Stock and other sites that I did not put on here. Etsy is a marketplace where there's a bunch of handmade crafts, but there's also a lot of SVGs and PNGs that people have uploaded. Some they've hand-drawn and some are AI generated. And then if you want a very particular custom piece of art, you can go onto outsourcing sites like Fiverr or Upwork. You can go onto Instagram and message your favorite artist and be like, hey, can you make a commission? How much would it cost? How long would it take to do blah? But if you do not want to have someone else make the art, then you can make it yourself. And a few popular programs are here. GIMP is very much similar to Photoshop in that it is, you go pixel by pixel. They're like brushes and stuff, but you're working with a raster image where you're working with the pixels rather than a geometric shape. Krita is another free and open source program similar to Photoshop. However, it has a few layers in there where you can use vector art. So you can do a really nice combination of this painting process versus very like strict geometric shapes. It's also a nice animating program, but that doesn't necessarily help for the PCBs. And then if you want strict vector art, then Inkscape is the free and open source program to go with, and I use that a lot. There's a lot of good resources on YouTube and the rest of the internet on how to use all of these programs. And if you want to, if you get really, really, really frustrated with that, there are not free open source things, but also fairly cheap resources you can use. Canva is a web app that makes it really easy to make like anything you want, and mostly like prints and flyers and invites, I would use that. And they recently acquired Affinity Photo too. So I think Affinity is a suite of programs similar to the Adobe suite. They have an image editor, they have a vector editor, and like a paper design editor. So it's nice where there's just a one cost. You just buy the software once and then you keep it forever. Clip Studio Paint is what I really like using. It's very popular in manga artists, and it has a really nice painting as well as vector art thing you can use. And the Silhouette Studio I mentioned before is a like a sister program to their vinyl cutters that they have. And then, which the good old Google Image Search or whatever search engine of your choice, where you just do royalty free, and then whatever you want to look at. So here I searched royalty free wedding art. And I got a few pieces that I liked. So this is the couple, and then there's some swooshes and swirls, and a flower that I could start working with. But in order to get this into something that we can mail out as an invite to all of our guests, I need to edit it down. So I used a combination of Clip Studio Paint, Inkscape, Krita, depending on how I was feeling that day, and got it down. So I made some edits to the dress where it is now much shorter. The train is gone. And then I made some edits to the top of the dress where I just liked this style of cut more. That's similar to what I wore to my engagement. And speaking of like our engagement photos, I took this and I just edited our noses onto it. So those are our noses at the top there. Just a really nice touch for that I know about that maybe not everyone receiving it knows about, but now you all know too. So we got a nice front, and at this point I like also printed it out to make sure that the size was correct, because we're going to be mailing it out, and also to see if there's going to be space for electronics, because we're going to be wanting to put LEDs and to have like this touch sensor on there as well. And so we're just going to be like, let's just stuff that all in the back. And then, so that's why there's like a empty space over here, just for those electronics. And we went through more iterations of what the back would look like, but just here's a handful of going, what is this design that's gonna end up here? So did a combination of the flower and the little swirlies that I found earlier. And then eventually my fiance was like, hey, can you, there's like a S there, and his name is Steven. Can you put like an L there? So now our initials are in this little flower, and it's been really fun to put that kind of like everywhere, like all throughout our wedding. Yes, so now we have a front and the back, and at this point I would like to note, if you are going to be doing this, make sure that you keep the layers separate. Whatever colors that you're going to be working with, you want to be able to export them later in order to import into like a PCB making software. So this white thing is going to need to be on the silkscreen layer. The gold is going to need to be part of the sweater mask layer. And yes, and then I'm missing something, but white, gold, copper. Okay, moving on to design the PCBs. You're going to need to use a software to do that, that will keep track of both the electronics that you're working with and the connections between those components, and then to be able to help you lay everything out and keep all of the voltages playing nicely and you're not shorting everything together. So KiCad, or KiCad, KiCad is going to be the reigning champion right now, I think, in terms of free and open source, but there are lots of other options out there. LibrePCB is also another free and open source software that you can use. For free versions, I recently found out Altium, which is, I think, the industry standard of printed circuit board design software, also is releasing a free piece called Circuit Maker. I haven't tried it out yet, haven't seen any reviews, I just wanted to toss that up there. And then I personally ended up using Easy EDA because that is a software built by JLC PCB, which is a PCB manufacturing house in China. And they have it really easy to look up the parts that are available that they can solder with, that they can assemble with, and then it automatically has the footprints. So I know that everything is going to play nicely with each other. And then as another option for if you want to pay money, I've used UpTrace before in the past, and I liked it, so I just wanted to put that up there. In all of these, there's going to be a schematic part. So here's the schematic that I used. There's going to be a battery holder here where I've used a CR2032 battery, just a little coin cell. And then I put 7 LEDs. So if you look here, there's going to be 5 LEDs that I put on the front and then 2 LEDs on the back. And then, those are these white LEDs up here. And then the red LEDs down there are a special gift for our friends, where I modified about 10 of the boards so that we would have red glowing eyes, which is really fun. And then connected, so all of these LEDs, all the anodes are connected together, and I connected to a LED driver. I use the CN5711. So on these pins 5 and 6, you connect that to the anode of the LED. This pin 8 here is CE, the chip enable. And when it's high, the LEDs are turned on. And when it's low, the LEDs are turned off. The pins 3 and 4, the VCC, that you just put power in. I think there's a range of like 3 to 5 volts. Ground is ground. And then the I set is current set. And then resistance that she put there determines the amount of current that it's going to start driving to LEDs. So, yes, so it'll put a max limit on the current that the LEDs will be driven with, so there's less chance of them burning out. And you can also have like power savings as well if you put it at a low enough current. And then, oh, yes, there are two problems with this, with the circuit. Before I move forward, I would like to throw it out to the audience if someone wants to say what they think might be wrong. Yes, so he said the driving different color LEDs without separate resistors. White LEDs turn on at different color at a different voltage than the red LEDs. So, as you'll see later, when I got the boards back, when I put the red LEDs on, the white LEDs don't turn on. So, that kind of captures both of the things I found. You should have current limiting resistors with your LEDs. It also like stabilize the voltages, I think. And then if I had put LEDs in there, I would have been able to have better control over the brightness, and I would have been able to let both the red and white LEDs turn on at the same time. So do that. And then the last thing on this board is a capacitive sensor. I use the TTP233H. There's a few of these with a similar name that kind of all do the same thing. Pin one is this Q, which is the output of the capacitive sensor. It'll, in this mode, it'll be high when it senses a hand, and then it'll be low when it doesn't sense a hand. I may have gotten that flipped. You can also turn it into a toggle mode where it'll latch up high, and it'll just switch between the high and low, no matter how long your hand is there. And the eye is the sensing pad of the, is where you need to connect the sensing pad to the sensor. Yes, so I would like to have had more stuff about how to make the layout of it, but you kind of, you have like the physical footprints of each of the parts. You have the background. So when you're making the art, I ended up having a SVG that is the outside layer that becomes the board outline. Yes, and then I think I uploaded a PNG into Easy EDA in order to make the silk screen. If you, whatever schematic or PCB software you're using, if you search up like how to import images into X software, there will be tutorials, or there should be. Yes, and then after you make that, then you need to make some Gerber files, which is just a fancy way of saying these pictures. You need to get these pictures and send them over to the PCB fabrication house. So on the left is the copper top pour. So anywhere you see red is where copper will be. And you can see I've kind of filled the whole area with red. And then in the middle, it looks like blue lines, but they're also red. There's red in those blue lines. And those are the traces going to the different LEDs. So you can see that there are the LEDs going to the flowers, and then there are traces going up to the eyes as well. Yes, and then in the middle, there's a solder mask, where everywhere there is blue, there is not going to be solder mask, the opposite of what the copper pour copper is. So where there's not going to be solder mask, the metal will be showing, because that's where I put all the metal, and where the metal is showing, there's going to be gold, because when I order the PCBs, I'll get it with the Enig finish. And then on the right side, there is the silkscreen image, and that'll be the white that gets printed on top. Similarly, on the bottom side, there is an image that defines where the copper goes. There is an image that defines where the solder mask doesn't go. And then there's an image that defines where the silkscreen goes. In order to order the PCBs, there's a lot of different places to get it. JLC PCB and PCBWay are, I think, the cheapest options right now. They have a giant factories in China, and it's really easy to get the parts over there as well. Giant factories. They do assembly as well as the PCB manufacturing. Oshpark is really nice. That it's open source hardware. Park, and what they do is they take everyone's tiny boards, and then they conglomerate it into like one giant order in order to reduce the cost for like hobbyists or just prototypes as well, if you're just trying to get small quantities. So I use those a lot in college. Sierra Circuits and Sunstone Circuits I've used before for work, where they're like American side. They can also do Hello, hello. There we go. Yeah. I did not put a timer on to see how much time I had left, but hot air reflow. I really think the magnifying lamp is one of the most important things on here, other than the soldering iron. I would put it above helping hands. I don't know, maybe it's just me. Yeah, and then the reflow oven to be able to heat up the whole board, a fume extractor so you don't get dizzy and pass out from the fumes. I want to show the pocket multimeter, which is a really nice device that it like Bluetooths to your phone. And so you can like put your phone wherever you want to like make it easier to see, and then you can make it easier to see like as you're probing stuff down. And it has like recording capabilities in it too and stuff. Yeah. So after I ended up going with the just pay money and have someone else make everything for me route, I went with JLC PCB, and it ended up being $3.12 per invite, and that includes the board making, all of the parts, and the assembly of it all, which was a lot cheaper than I was expecting it to be when I, yeah, it was a lot cheaper than I expected it to be. And that, like, yeah, that also includes the shipping. And I think I was able to get that cheaply because I was using parts part of their like general library. You'll notice on the bottom right here this extended components fee. That's for the parts that were not part of their general library. So like resistors and capacitors, like a bunch of really common things you don't have to pay as much for. Yes, and if I had gone with like a microcontroller and they're like a little AT Tiny, then it would have increased the price by a lot. So. A few weeks later, a bunch of PCBs come in, and I get to start testing them out. And there were a few floating around. And I get to scratch off some of the solder mask and solder the red LEDs to where the eyes are and have those glow. And as soon as I soldered them on and noticed that the white LEDs did not turn on, I was like, oh, right, that that makes sense. They need different voltages. So this is also when I noticed that instead of it working as I intended, where you kind of just wave your hand near it for it to turn on, you need to touch both the front and the back in order for it to turn on. I also realized that I made a goof when I go back to here, this top copper pour and this bottom copper pour, this red up here, for the top, I put as the ground plane, because when you make PCBs, it's typically good practice to have a ground plane. Everything is going to need to access ground, and then it's also good for some EMI shielding purposes as well. And then the bottom plane is I made the whole bottom plane I made as the sensing plane, which I'm like, okay, there's going to be a really large plate for the capacitive sensor to sense. So what I should have done is not put the ground plane on, and maybe I can get this to work, where I tried kind of recreating the circuit in just copper tape, so I don't have the ground plane and the blocking it. And this was working earlier, where it was off, where the LEDs are off normally, and then when I bring my hands closer, the LEDs turn on. And when what goes away, it turns on. So this is what I was originally wanting the PCBs to do. But it was good enough to start shipping out. But I wanted to really like try to understand what was going on. So with the capacitor, a capacitor is typically two metal plates or two conductive plates that are near each other, and you apply a voltage across, and you can store energy in an electric field. The amount of energy you can store is kind of the capacitance, and that's determined by this equation here, where by a factor of epsilon, the capacitance is directly related to the area of the electrodes, and the capacitance is inversely related to the distance between the electrodes. So as you bring the plates closer together, the capacitance will increase. As you bring them further apart, the capacitance will decrease. And how a capacitive sensor that's detecting a hand will work is that there's just one plate of the capacitor there. And the other plate is usually the world the just earth, ground, the metal, and the walls, something that's really far away. So the capacitance is really small. But as you bring your hand closer, the bodies are a little conductive. You can act as the other plate of the capacitor. So this brings the distance down a lot between the two plates because you're the other plate, and the capacitance will increase some. So the little IC that I have on there is trying to detect that change in capacitance, that increase in capacitance. Let's see, this is a circuit that's very blurry. You cannot tell what any of these words say. But this capacitor up here is trying to model the capacitance between the electrode and your finger. And then this one down here is trying to be the capacitance of the electrode to the local ground. And I made that really, really large by making the ground, the top metal part, be fully ground. If I had not had that ground, then it would have worked better. The sensor would have, the electric field would have been trying to sense the rest of the world instead of just the ground plane there. So yes, so that is why it wouldn't turn on when I bring my hand close. And then I'm still not sure why it turns on when you touch the front and the back together. It has to do something with the circuit that's inside of the capacitive sensor. And my best guess is that on this top left here next to the input, there's a sensor oscillator circuit. So I think in order to sense the change in capacitance, there's going to be a capacitor as part of either an inductor capacitor oscillator or a resistive capacitive oscillator. And then when the capacitance isn't changing, then the oscillation is going to be fairly stable. And then when I conduct the front to the back, that means that the oscillator will stop oscillating. And so it just becomes flat. And it'll always be looking for a lower and lower capacitance, but it can't get any lower than an oscillator that isn't oscillating. I'm sorry if that was confusing. I barely understand it myself. In the end, the black magic of all of the electronics makes it work when you when you grab the invitation, so we were still get to send everything out. And in order to mail it, we went through USPS, where it should be 2 ounces, so 68 cents for the first ounce, 24 cents for the second ounce, and 44 cents to make it a rigid non-machinable, where they should be hand sorting everything. That doesn't always work. And then there are other rules of sending lithium through the mail because it has a tendency of catching on fire. With these that I found, it basically needs to be pre-installed. Because I'm using a coin cell battery, I don't need to put a label on the outside of the package. If it was another lithium, then you do have to put a sticker on. And then you need to the coin cell needs to be less than 1 gram of lithium content. So that's good. I don't think the battery even weighs a gram, so we're good on that. And the envelope that you send needs to not be more than a quarter inch thick, which I'll get to later. But in order to quote-unquote install the battery into the invite and have it so that the battery won't go flying when the mail goes everywhere, I used my Silhouette machine in order to cut through some transparencies that I printed out on. So it has a little arrow on the left side. There's a little slit next to the words "pull here" that the arrow goes into, and it just wraps around the battery and prevents it from connecting to the ground of the board and prevents it from turning on until you remove the plastic tab. That was fun to experiment with and make. And then I also used my curio in order to write onto these envelopes the addresses of my guests, and there's these black envelopes with the gold border that we just got off of Amazon, and we got that to match the look of the invites. Then when everything is put together, I get 0.2495 inches, which is right below the 0.25 inches. So we just went ahead and tried putting it into the USPS and mail everything out. A few of them arrived a little damaged on the left here. We sent out about 100 of them. 5 of them actually got returned, saying we don't have enough postage on there and that we need to send it out with, this is $3.51 more. I'm not sure why 95 of them got through fine and 5 of them got returned, but whatever. Ended up resending them using this like black bubble mailer, also found on Amazon. And then in order to get really nice shipping rates, used a website called The Pirate Ship, which like goes across USPS, UPS, FedEx in order to get really cheap rates to ship everywhere. And we'll see if this video goes. Of people reacting to it really well. There's no sound. It's okay. Yeah. That's all I have to say. You can check out my website for some projects that I did back in college. That also has contact information and a way to get to my LinkedIn. And my Instagram is solid.mirage, where I'll be having more wedding projects that I'm posting there. Yeah. That's all I got.